Hello everybody! As said in the introduction video, I'll be telling you guys something more about Howard Becker's major work, Whose Side Are We On? First, I will give you a quick introduction of Becker's point of view, followed by his key concepts and ideas. Further on, I will discuss some other authors who have had a major influence in the discussion whether or not we should take sides in social research, and how we should think about bias or partisan researchers today. So, according to Becker, the question is not whether we should take sides, but rather whose side do we take? This is immediately the title of his work, but what does Becker mean by taking sides? Some researchers show too much sympathy with a group of people which are studied. Other researchers try to maintain the sympathy to a minimum to preserve a value-free research. In this study, there are no clear hypotheses, yet in my opinion there are two main questions. The first one is to have values or not to have values within research, and if we choose to have values, the second question is whose side are we on? These questions will be dealt with throughout this presentation, but let's have a quick look at the second question. In sociological research, the researchers are tempted to always look and choose the side of the so-called underdog. They try to think that these underdogs in questions are at least as good as anyone else. This means that they mean no harm, yet are in a situation that makes them the underdog and there is nothing to do about it. This idea will bring researchers some sympathy for the group, while other people of society look at the underdogs as unfit to have responsibility within society. This is called a certain form of bias, because if these feelings were made explicit, it would mean that the researcher is biased and the results of the research might be twisted. This is also called a partisan research, where the problem being studied will be assessed as a problem that's viewed from only one side. But how does this bias occur and does it change? According to Becker, this can be made clear by the following key concepts and ideas. Accusation of bias arises when a researcher gives credence, so acceptance of belief, to the perspective of the subordinate group, also called the underdogs, in some hierarchical relationship. Let's take a look at this hierarchy. As you can see, this hierarchy consists of two groups, the superordinates and the subordinates. The superordinate group are those who represent the forces of approved and official morality. These parties are usually the official and professional authorities, and they are in charge of some important institution. They control the subordinates and they make sure they don't keep violating the ethics or morals that are common within society. So, for example, the police, principals, hospitals or psychologists, or prison guards, whatever stands above the subordinate group. So the subordinate group are those who, alleged or assumed, have violated this morality and ethics of society. Now these parties only use the services of above called institutions, so like drug addicts, students, patients, prisoners, whatever has violated morality according to superordinate group. So in this easy example, we take a look at the prison guard who represents the superordinates, which are superior to the prisoners. So this prisoner is a subordinate who has violated the morals and ethics of society, according to superordinates, and therefore has to be punished. Now that this hierarchical relation between the superordinates and the subordinates has been made clear, we can take a look at Becker's two explanations why taking the side of the underdog, the subordinates, and giving a voice to the voiceless could be perceived as biased. There are two cases which differ to explain these perceptions, and I will explain them to you right now. So first we're going to take a look at the apolitical case on the basis of previous explained hierarchy. Within this hierarchy there is a lot of conflict and tension between the two groups, yet these conflicts haven't become openly political to discuss. Now what does Becker mean by that? It means that these ranks of superordinate and subordinate are not organized for conflict. For example, the subordinate group is very unorganized and has nothing to say. And because of this unorganized character of these underdogs, no one attempts to alter the shape of this hierarchy. So this hierarchy can also be explained by the hierarchy of credibility. This means that it is a given that members of the highest group in the hierarchy, so in this case the superordinates, have more knowledge and the right to define the way that things really are and how they have to be solved. This means that members of the subordinate groups have lower incomplete information and they will have a partial view of reality and they have no clue what is going on and how society should function. And this is all part of common sense, because everybody knows that the responsible professionals on top know more about things and they have to be taken seriously. So it's kind of accepted within the hierarchy that the group at the top knows best. This also means that credibility and authority and the right to be heard are differentially distributed through the ranks of the systems. So the subordinates don't have a voice to help them out of their position, while the superordinates are in charge of kind of everything. So when are sociological researchers accused of bias within this apolitical system? It is proof that sociologists don't give the responsible superordinates, such as prison guards, a chance to explain themselves, such as why are the complaints of prisoners not justified? Yet there are many other studies in different fields that are biased in the direction of the interest of responsible officials than the other way around. This is because the superordinates parties are responsible. They have been entrusted with our important institutions, such as schools, hospitals, and they can do something when things are not what they are supposed to be, but also will be held account if they fail to make these institutions work. Because subordinates are not organized in such fashion as to be responsible for operation and functioning of these institutions, they also have no reason to complain of bias towards the superordinate parties. This has to do with the lack of voice and lack of organization within the subordinate group, because when they don't take care or take responsibility for the group's welfare, they likewise don't have any complaints if someone else criticizes, like the superordinate group. And this is the reason why we accuse ourselves only of bias when we will take the side of the subordinate party in this apolitical situation. Now let's take a look at the second case. So the second case is the political case. In this case, the same hierarchy is used as in the apolitical case, yet within the same hierarchies, these parties try either to maintain their position, this is what the superordinates do, or try to change the existing relations of power and authority, and this is what the subordinates do. The subordinate group has much to lose. In contrast to the apolitical case, they do have some degree of organizations and also have a spokesman. This makes them equal to the superordinates in terms of organization. The spokesmen are held responsible for the assertions of the groups and is either focused on changing or maintaining these existing hierarchical relationships. And because both parties are equally in terms of organization, accusation of bias in this case arises when a scientist or researcher gives credence and so much, in other words, belief to the perspective of either party to the political conflict. But is there something we can do about this bias? Whatever point of view the researchers take, they have to make sure that the research they are about to share with the world meets the standards of good scientific work, and that the sympathies with the groups being studied do not make these results invalid. So what can they do to reduce their bias to a minimum? At first, they can try to avoid sentimentality, to make sure that they have used all techniques and theories that are open enough to allow them to prove their biases are untrue. And secondly, there is thought about a simple solution. Namely, we have to study those superordinates and subordinates presenting their point of view regarding their relations with their superiors, so we can gain a deeper sympathy with them and avoiding the one-sided identification. So let's take a look at the ground hierarchy. We have the two groups as discussed before, and in this point of view, superordinates must also contend to those who are recognized as superior. I will call them in this case a regulator. To make clear, this is not a term Becker used, yet I use it to make clear that there are people that stand above the superordinates, which are superior and make the rules for the superordinate group to follow up. So this has been viewed as a simple solution, but it won't work according to Becker, because we will get in the same trouble with a new set of officials. This is also called the problem of infinite regress. So the desire to do better by the officials or for example, the prison guards is frustrated and regulated by his or her superior. So the long-standing problem with subordinates and superordinates, which elaborates a lot of discussion, will now expand to a much bigger problem. So I think for now it is perfectly clear what Howard Becker tries to learn us with his article, Whose Side Are We On? There are two sides to be taken in social research, yet these choices get affected by political ideas, hierarchies, and this makes us usually choose the side of the subordinates. And these sides will inevitably be taken, even if we try our best not to let ourselves be biased. But has it always been okay to let failures intervene our research? Now we're going to take a look at some key authors in this discussion about bias and partisanship and what their view is regarding to have failures or not to have failures within research. So I think there are two key authors within the discussion, namely Weber and Goldner. First, I'm going to explain the ideas of Max Weber, but I don't have the time to explain all his ideas regarding values within research, so let's take a look at some key points. In contrast to Becker, Weber said it is indeed possible to not take sides within social research. So the most important idea of Weber is there must be a value-free sociology. This means that sociologists, while doing such social research, must limit value relevance. So this means that researchers should exclude ideological and non-scientific assumptions from their research. But how? According to Weber, they should not make evaluative judgment about the evidence that they have gathered, just based on ideological ideas. So for example, it is no secret that most sociologists are political liberal, and that they usually take sides of the underdog. But for Weber, it was a must that the spread of political ideals be brought to a stop. So there are also a few researchers that don't agree with Weber's value-free research design. As this quote from Herbert Gans explained, we cannot do away with the fact that research, like all human activities, is political, that it supports one point of view and its vested interest at the expense of others. The researcher must therefore take a political stand on some issues, and he or she should make it clear where his or her sympathies lie. This means Gans supports Becker and not Weber on the fact that the question is not do we take sides, but rather whose side do we take. Becker and Gans both get their support from Kleiman and Kopp, as they said our emotional reactions often reveal our political beliefs. And what we've learned from Mead is that when people look through a symbolic interactionistic perspective, they assume that emotions are social and cultural products which individuals have some control over. This would mean that we really could try to avoid sentimentality and sympathy with certain types of groups we are studying in the field of political studies. Yet, social researchers will inevitably take sides whether or not they are willing to admit so. Now let's take a look at Goldner. So then we have Goldner, which is a very important name within the discussion of bias and values within social research. So Goldner's critique on Weber's value-free research was the fact that this could be called the myth of a value-free research. So he called it an excuse of no longer thinking seriously about social problems without taking sides. So in this extent, Goldner makes clear that there are indeed sides to be taken within social research. Yet he also criticized Becker's view of taking sides. I'm going to explain his critique with this quote. So the emphasis in Becker's theory is on the deviant as the product of society rather than as a rebel against it. If this is a liberal conception of deviance that wins sympathy and tolerance for the deviant, it has a paradoxical consequence of inviting us to view the deviant as a passive nonentity who is responsible neither for his suffering nor its alleviation, who is mere sinned against than sinning. So as we can read above, Goldner criticized the fact that the deviant in Becker's theory is represented as a passive and not an active deviant. A passive deviant is seen as a man on his back and not as a man who is fighting back to restore justice. So with this being said, Goldner accused Becker of producing an underdog sociology, wherein the perspective is produced that this underdog is abused by a bureaucratic establishment. So this would have led to a partisan research, or rather a partisan sociology, according to Goldner. So, as we have compared Becker's idea with some similar authors with their perception on bias and values within research, it has been made perfectly clear that there are always sides to be taken within social research. So, to intensify the statement, these principles of value neutrality and objectivity are widely rejected today. That being said, doing value-free research is impossible, because we take sides as our personal and political ideals command. And we use theoretical, technical researches and methods to avoid misrepresentation of bias that might have an influence on our research. So researchers can always try to satisfy the demands of society by always making clear what kind of limits our research has and what we have studied. We have to warn people that our study tells us how things look from a certain point of view, and for example does not attempt to explain why superordinates like prison guards do what they do. So there are sides to be taken, and we cannot do this without any values and subjectivity. So I really hope I explained everything well and clear, and that I've broadened your knowledge about Becker's whose side are we on. Thank you for watching.